of sexual harassment. Today amidst us we have a renowned lawyer, author, and ethicist, Swapna Sundar, who is here to enlighten us on the ways to prevent sexual harassment. It is my privilege and pleasure to introduce and welcome Ms. Swapna Sundar. Swapna Sundar is a lawyer with a degree in political science. After a master's in law from the Brussels School of International Studies and a stint as a teaching assistant at the University of Kent at Canterbury, UK, where she supported lectures in British constitutional law, she returned to Chennai to establish IP Dome IP Strategy Advisors, a multidisciplinary firm working on international strategies for IP monetization. In addition to several publications in newspapers and academic journals, Swapna is the author of several books and textbooks. She is currently practicing law and teaching courses relating to law and technology at Nalsar University, Asian College of Journalism, National Institute of Fashion Technology, and is a guest faculty for IPR at several institutions, including VIT and Symbiosis University. She is currently the chairperson of the Apollo Biomedical Research Committee, Chennai, and also a member ethics committee of the National Institute of Epidemiology and several hospitals, including SIMS and Fortis Mullar. She is also a member ethics committee at IIT Madras. She is member board of studies of the Department of Sociology, Loyola, and for IPR at Symbiosis Law School. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you so much. It's always a pleasure to speak to women and speak about preventing something from happening. So I've been working with the Rotary on Youth Protection and Prevention of Sexual Abuse and Harassment of Youth and among women on sexual harassment of women. So it's very difficult in this country to say how we can completely avoid it, but it's important and we are taking steps, and that's a good thing always. So before I proceed to the law and to what we have come here to discuss, I would just like to say that a sexual harassment policy is not only meant to prevent sexual harassment of women or protect women employees. It also protects the institution. This is something that very often we tend to forget. An institution has many stakeholders. It has customers, it has management, it has employees. It may also have contract employees, vendors, and so on. But an institution has a life of its own. And if a sexual harassment or sexual abuse allegation is not dealt with appropriately, then it could mean that the institution may go through such a scandal, or it may go through such a long case that it will be difficult for the college to operate. In fact, many of the prevention protocols in other countries, including the US and many of the institutions in Europe, look at sexual harassment and equal opportunity policies as more protecting the institution than protecting any of the stakeholders involved. This is a very important criteria and very important perspective to understand. In India, there have been several cases where companies have been hauled up for not having a proper functioning internal complaints committee or a complaints committee that is appropriately staffed with the right kind of people in the quorum. One particular case is Geeta Balasubramaniam versus Verizon, where Verizon was forced to pay $3 million because in an Indian court before the Delhi High Court, because they didn't have an internal complaints committee. So quite often, like an NGO like Rotary or an NGO like IWA or YWCA or YMCA do not realize that a sexual harassment committee or a youth protection committee are meant to protect the institution as much as the subject of that law. Secondly, the second person that it protects, apart from the victim or apart from the aggrieved person, is the person who might commit the crime. Let me give you an example. There is a last year in Tamil Nadu, there was a big Me Too movement. And one of the very surprising areas that were covered were the schools teaching and teaching Bharatanatyam and Carnatic music. It was a very shocking revelation to many of us who are outside that industry, if you can call it, or that vocation or that occupation, to know how many children are being or suffering abuse and harassment at the hands of their teachers, at the hands of the family members of their gurus, and so on. Very important here, what is to understand is that if there is no framework, then a person feels empowered to do illegal activities. If there is a framework, and if the framework is very clear, and if the framework sets out what is appropriate behavior, what is inappropriate behavior, then those people who are inclined towards inappropriate behavior will either stay away from the organization, or at least within the organization, they will behave themselves. I'll give you an example. During that same Me Too crisis, it was astounding for us. So we worked with a campaign. It was astounding for us to realize that many of the persons who were coming forward with Me Too allegations were boys and young children. Whereas in the rest of the world, the Me Too campaign was mostly about adult women complaining about their professional colleagues or professional superiors. Here in India, we faced a lot of queries from parents and young children and adolescents, of course. So not very young children, not 5-year-old, 6-year-old. We don't even know what is happening to them. But 19-year-olds and 18-year-olds and 15-year-olds, both boys and girls. And what we realized was that the framework, the Carnatic music environment, the Bharatanatyam environment, and not just Carnatic music and Bharatanatyam, maybe Kuchipudi or whatever it is that they're learning, has no framework to protect or protect the aggrieved person or to inform the abuser that this is right or wrong. In one particularly sad example, the Sun TV producer, one of the Sun TV producers of children's programs, was also charged or pointed out as a person who was being harassing towards young children. So in one particular instance, the girl came forward and said that he asked that the child be auditioned without the parent. So the child would be taken into the room to be auditioned. Now, what happens inside the room, we don't know. And very often, we also tend to disbelieve children. This is one of our big faults as a community. We tend to disbelieve children. We tend to question adult victims, but children we tend to disbelieve. So we actually don't know what happens in the room. Now, had there been a policy in Sun TV or in the production industry, there is, for instance, the BBC has a framework for working with children. And in that, very specifically, they say that no child should be alone without a parent or guardian with any of the employees of BBC. So there is no framework. So once there is a framework, and once the framework specifies certain behaviors are wrong, then it's very easy to prevent at least 90% of these opportunities from occurring. And if we're able to minimize the opportunities, then we're also able to prevent that many occurrences. This is the way in which we should look at the sexual harassment law and the sexual harassment policy. In spite of this, certain events will take place. In that case, we have to understand how the law deals with it. So I am seeing that most of the participants here are faculty members. Is that right? Am I right, Revati ma'am? Or are there also students? Because
ma'am, students are also there.
Are also there. Okay. So as this issue is, excuse me a minute. As this issue is quite a sensitive issue, I would like how they say in on TV, advise discretion. So please understand that these are statements that I'm making because the law speaks about these things. If you have any particular queries, you can always ask me. If you are prefer to ask on the chat or the conversation, feel free to ask me. I actually took a break there because my daughter had come in and she's 11 years old and I don't think this subject is appropriate for her. So I'm going to share my screen. We're looking at the Protection of Women Against Sexual Harassment Act at the Harassment at the Workplace Act 2013. Before we ask any questions, let us just understand what the law says. The Act provides several very important definitions, and I also advise you, just don't go by this lecture and see and feel that you have understood the subject, because the subject is quite complex. But there is an MHRD handbook, which is issued in, I think, in 2014 and updated periodically, which is very good, very easy to understand. It is not meant for lawyers, so others can also understand. It's free for download. Please download that and keep it on your systems for easy reference. Now, the first definition is an aggrieved woman. Now, we need to understand that the Sexual Harassment of the Women at the Workplace Act is very specifically protects only women. It does not protect, say, other sexual minorities, for instance, gay people or transgender people. Although my definition would say that if a person identifies themselves as women, like if a transgender person identifies herself as a woman, then she should come under the Act. But as of now, the Act is very specifically protecting only women, which is, in my opinion, unfortunate, because I would say that there are as many sexual predators among women and as many sexual predators who are men who harass men at the workplace. So I would not say that this is a complete or comprehensive law of harassment in India, but this Act talks only about women. When they talk about women at the workplace, it does not only include employees. It includes anyone who is working there, which means that it could be a contract laborer. It could be someone who comes in the morning and leaves in the afternoon. It could be anyone visiting the workplace. So they might be visiting an employee at the workplace, or they might have come for some official work to the workplace. And they include students like interns and so on who work in for a brief period at the workplace, even those who are not paid. So those people who come on a voluntary basis to the workplace, they may be volunteers, they may be activists, they may have come to ask certain questions, even though they are protected under this Act. This includes daily wagers and ad hoc employees. So even if a person is working in several units, some organizations like the railways have several offices within the city, so they may be working in different offices on an ad hoc basis, they are also protected. Vendors, couriers, and any person employed through an agent is also protected. Apart from that, probationers, trainees, or any woman who enters the workplace is protected under the Sexual Harassment of Women at the Workplace Act. It's very interesting. Last year in November, a lady who was riding a scooter had to park at a toll plaza in Hyderabad. And you know what happened subsequently. Her bike was punctured, they say, deliberately by some persons who then abducted her, raped her, and then burnt or attempted to burn her body. And subsequently, four people were shot in an encounter by the police. Now, if you see in this entire incident, one idea or one scope of redressal has been missed. And that scope is that the toll plaza is a workplace. A toll plaza is a place where women work. So there can be booth attendants who are women, women who come there to perhaps do the cleaning. They visit the toll plaza. All types of women visit the toll plaza, drivers, passengers, maybe pedestrians. Students will visit the toll plaza. There may be people coming on voluntary basis to the toll plaza. And in any case, even if women are not there, the toll plaza is a workplace. So considering that the workplace and the definition of workplace, as well as the definition of the aggrieved woman, is quite wide in the Act, I think we have, in India, we have failed to really explore the scope of this act as widely as possible. Who's an employer? The head of the department is the employer. So if there is a problem in a multinational company with a branch in Chennai City, you need not go all the way to the national CEO or the international CEO of the company as employer. Employer is the head of that department or that unit or that workshop or that particular retail showroom where the employee works. So an employer, of course, there are many layers in the management, but not everyone will be considered an employer. It will be the person who is responsible for the management, supervision, and control of that workplace. And perhaps if the company doesn't have a company-wide policy or a company-wide implementation of the sexual harassment law, then definitely the senior people can be brought to answer for any issues that may occur at the workplace. One of the areas of confusion for people who are not in the law is what is the difference between harassment and abuse. Sexual harassment includes both sexual abuse and sexual harassment. But harassment by itself means the use of verbal assault, the use of criticism, and various other ways which may be non-contact to a point or may not have a criminal consequence. Let me explain that as we go forward, but please understand that abuse is physical in contact intended to cause pain, injury, or other physical suffering or harm, whereas harassment may have an element of physical contact, but is more about what it does to the person internally, what mental agony it causes to the person. For instance, rejecting the person, preventing them from developing a normal social relationship, making derogatory statements based on their gender, based on their way of clothing, based on their hairstyle, based on their complexion. All of that, provided it has to do with of a sexual nature, will come under sexual harassment. There is all other types of harassment also that is possible at the workplace. It may have to do with caste, it may have to do with place of birth, it may have to do with language. That is also harassment, but that is not sexual harassment. Sexual harassment has to do particularly with sexual intent. Sexual abuse and sexual harassment are also two different things. In India, sexual harassment and sexual abuse both may come under criminal law, may be treated as a criminal offense, and sexual harassment in particular may also be treated as a civil offense. In sexual abuse includes activities such as explicit sexual acts, or pressuring someone to perform sexual acts, or engaging directly with another person or gender of any age through force or coercion with a sexual act. And in very importantly, such person should be unable or unwilling or not in a position to give consent. So the person may be drunk, they may be intoxicated, or they may be just scared. And what are they frightened about, or what are they scared about? They may be scared about losing their reputation. They may be scared about losing their job. They may be worried about economic consequences, financial consequences. It could be that they were afraid that they will not get a promotion. So all of these reasons are possibilities for not being able to give consent or not being able to resist, even though they don't give consent. So it is possible that a person may not openly come and say, don't do this, but they may mean and feel it, but they are unable to come out and say that. Against the person who commits the crime or who is alleged to have committed the crime under the sexual harassment law is called the respondent. So the respondent is the person against whom the complainant, who is the woman, who is the aggrieved person, makes a complaint. And that complaint has to be made under a specific law, a specific section called Section 9. So under Section 9, several aspects of sexual harassment will be covered. I also, before moving on, I just want to also make another small distinction between gender harassment and sexual harassment. So here are the different ways in which sexual harassment can be done. calling people by sexual nicknames, telling sexual jokes, making references to their sexual conduct, or gossiping about somebody's sex life. All of these will come under sexual harassment, about obscene languages and gestures, putting up a poster on or a wallpaper on a publicly displayed system will all come under sexual harassment. Gender harassment is slightly different from this. I'm sure that if you're a woman, you have come across an uncle or a senior person in your organization who has told you, ma'am, why don't you wear a dupatta? Why don't you wear a bindi? Why are you coming to, why are you tucking your shirt in your pants? Why do you wear nail polish on your toes? Now, if you see, this is not sexual harassment because they don't have any sexual interest in you. But it is gender harassment because they are targeting the gender in us or gender in the woman. So they would not probably ask a man, why are you tucking a shirt in your pants? Or they would not ask a man, why are you not wearing the top button of your shirt? But they will ask that of a woman. That is gender harassment. It is not, women might feel offended about it, and we do respond to it. Some of us may say, what is your problem about it, and so on. But it's something that we deal with. One area in which gender harassment is quite apparent is the media and social media. So you'll find pictures of girls who quite unconsciously appear attractive to the other gender. And they put up saying, oh, look at the way she dresses, see how she has worn this dress, or look how her sandals are, or see how tightly she's worn her belt, and so on. This comes under gender harassment. It's important to understand because this act prevents sexual harassment but does nothing about gender harassment. What is a workplace? So I just discussed with you about the toll plaza being a workplace, but many other areas that we enter and work also with are workplaces. For instance, hospitals and nursing homes, NGOs, temples, ashram that we go to, some yoga retreat or Ayurveda retreat that we go to, madarsas or churches, or any places where we go on a retreat, like a church retreat or a religious gathering, sports facilities, government organization. It could be a government or company or a government office. So the ration office, for instance, when we go to get a ration card, and so on. So educational institution, farms, and so on. In this context, it's very important to understand that a house is a workplace for a domestic employee, domestic servant. So a person who comes to work in our house as a cook or as a person to clean the house, or a carpenter or a plumber or any other work that they do in our house, for them, our house is a workplace. For us, our house is not a workplace. That is why a woman who suffers domestic abuse in her own house undergoes domestic abuse or domestic violence. But if there is a servant who comes to our house and undergoes abuse, then for her, our house is a workplace. And therefore, that comes under the Prevention of Sexual Harassment at the Workplace Act. It's a very important understanding that we must have. The Act very specifically lists some of the activities that are considered sexual harassment. This is not a comprehensive list. Many more things are possible, but this is what the Act has listed. Physical contact and advances. In a case called Shanta Kumar versus CSIR in the Delhi High Court, they have said that all physical contact is not sexual harassment. It seems easy to understand, but it's also spelled out in the Act. So in that particular case, in Shanta Kumar versus CSIR, Shanta Kumar, apparently there was some pre-existing dispute, some kind of a work-related dispute between Shanta Kumar and the management of the CSIR unit. And she had come in to work in the lab, and one of the respondents had come and had bodily taken hold of her arms and put her outside the lab and locked the lab.
Now, is this sexual harassment? No, this is not sexual. It is harassment. It may come under harassment, it may come under violence, it may come under assault, perhaps it may come under involuntary physical detention or whatever, but it is not sexual harassment. So it does not, the definition does not say that whenever a male person touches a female person, it is sexual harassment. No. Physical contact in this case means physical contact with sexual intent, or physical contact which is coercive, physical contact which intends or goes towards sexual advances and so on is sexual harassment. A demand or request for sexual favor, making sexually colored remarks. So I have found this and faced it, and sometimes it's very embarrassing. If you are in a group where there are more men than women, you will find that the men tend to gang up together and make some sort of jokes which are sexually colored, or more often they are gender biased jokes. Now, will all such sexually colored jokes or remarks be treated as sexual harassment? Maybe if it is to a hostile level, it is to a level at which the woman or the women employees are unable to work there, then it is sexual harassment. One instance of a joke may be made in a party where there is a mixed crowd may not be considered to be sexual harassment. But in a workplace, in a professional setting, where in a professional context, when four or five people are having a conference or a meeting, the men gang up together and make sexually colored remarks to such an extent that the women feel left out, or have feel that they don't have a part to play, that may be sexual harassment. Showing pornography or any other unwelcome physical, verbal or non-verbal conduct of sexual nature. So very often it happens that women may feel comfortable with a certain group of men with whom they are friendly, with whom they have more freedom. So in such cases, it is possible that they might discuss something of a sexual nature. That may not be treated as sexual harassment. However, saying that you are able to discuss with this man issues of a sexual nature, why don't you discuss issues of sexual nature with me, might be termed as sexual harassment. So in this case, it is more about whether the woman or women employees are comfortable with that situation. So it's a little difficult to decide, because we all come from different backgrounds. Some of us come from progressive, urban, English-educated backgrounds. We go to bars, we may go to dancing, or we may have more open-minded families, or we may watch more wider selection of movies from, say, France or Spain or Cuba or South America, where life is more easy or more progressive than it is here. On the other hand, there may be some people who come from a more restricted society where they have a clearer boundary about what is permitted, not permitted, who have a narrower understanding of sexual relations or gender relations, might find something harassing which another group may not. So it is a lot to do with the comfort level of the women who are there in that particular situation. What is not sexual harassment? We just discussed this. What is required of an employer? So every employer has to constitute an internal complaints committee. By law, if there are 10 women working in a unit, there should be an internal complaints committee. What happens if there are 9 women working in the unit? Then they approach what is called the local complaints committee. Maybe I have a little something about that in a few slides down the presentation. But the local complaints committee is constituted by the taluk office or the district office, and there the committee is similar in composition. But any institute or unit that doesn't have an internal complaints committee, or in certain other circumstances, a woman who is harassed can actually go to the local complaints committee. I have an example here of the railways, because we do some work with the railways. So if you see here, the internal complaints committee has to be there at every level, at the zonal level, at the divisional level, and the workshop level, depending on how many women are working in that particular workshop. For instance, the Madras High Court, there are about 600, 700 women lawyers, and I don't know, a large number of women who come there to work as registrars or officers in the courthouse. There are people who come in the cleaning staff, people who are there for the catering and hospitality. But there are a large number of litigants also who are women, but there is only one internal complaints committee. It actually is available or accessible to everyone, litigants, court judges, court staff, lawyers, and junior lawyers, and assistants and paralegals and so on. So it depends on how many units there are. Members of the internal complaints committee. So the first is that there should be a presiding officer who is a woman employee. So there is a rule that the president of the committee should be a woman. Not less than two members from amongst the employees who have experience in social work or have legal knowledge. One member from an NGO or association committed to the cause of women or a person familiar with issues relating to sexual harassment. Quite often, I find that corporate offices, they choose a lawyer because she's familiar with issues relating to sexual harassment, not only because she knows about sexual harassment, but because she understands the protocols that are involved in implementing the law. At least half of the total nominated members shall be women. And every member shall hold office only for a period of 3 years. If you look at this in total, you can have an internal complaints committee of five people, of whom three have to be women. One of them will be the president, and the other two women can be from one from the employees and one from the lawyer or NGO or whatever that organization you choose. The presiding officer has to be a woman employed at a senior level from amongst the employees. It's an interesting structure in this particular committee. For instance, when I work in the clinical trial ethics committee committees, the chairperson of the committee is always from outside the institute. But in this case, the presiding person has to be from inside the institute. It is only the NGO worker or lawyer who is from outside. Everybody else is an institutional member. In case senior level employees are not available in that particular unit, they can be brought from any other unit. So the railways generally has very senior employees only at the divisional level or at higher levels than that. At a small workshop in, say, Avadi, you may not have a senior woman. So in that case, the presiding officer will be another officer who sits there as a presiding officer, but she may not work in that particular workplace. In case other officers do not have senior level employees, they shall be nominated from any other workplace of the same employer or the department or organization. It has to be the same institution. So in MNCs, this happens quite often, that in multinational corporations in India, what happens is that the woman employee is generally chosen from either one of the metropolitan cities or the national head office, which may be in Mumbai or Delhi. A second tier, two-tier city like in Trichy or Coimbatore, you may not actually have a senior woman employee to be a presiding officer. The external member shall be entitled to an allowance of 200 per day. So sometimes this 200 token sum is given as sitting fee, but the external member's travel expenses or per diem may be paid. So let us say that a trial takes or an inquiry takes up to 20 days, then she will be paid 200 rupees per day and travel up and down or whatever may be organized for her. And whatever loss of time, so for instance, she may have a lawyer, may have to leave her cases for 20 days and come and sit there. So a compensatory amount may also be paid. How can a member be removed from the committee? They will be removed for following reasons: if they are convicted of an offense, if they have become bankrupt, if they are found guilty in departmental proceedings or any proceedings of that institution, disciplinary proceedings are pending against them, or if they have abused their position as to render their continuance in office prejudicial to public interest. So this means that if they have used their position as a member of the committee to either let off someone or to recommend someone to a post or a position, then they will be removed from the committee. I was talking about the local complaints committee. The local complaints committee is also composed of at least five people, three of whom have to be women, presided over by a woman from the local administration. The Tamil Nadu government has repeatedly said that all the LCCs are working, but my friends who work in women's rights often tell me that the district committees are not working, or at least they don't have a sitting. One problem that people may have in accessing the local complaints committee is where to file the complaint. Can they go to the local corporation office or local body office to file a complaint? No, they have to go to that particular office where the local complaints committee is sitting. So in the district, it is difficult to find out where that particular complaints committee is sitting. In fact, I don't know where in Chennai it sits. So if such a case occurs, then my advice is you can approach the State Women's Commission. So the State Women's Commission will direct you to the local complaints committee, or they themselves might take on the complaint at hand and help you to resolve the issue or help you to redress the grievance. The State Women's Commission is easier to access. Who can complain? In general, only the aggrieved woman can complain. No one else can complain. In fact, when I go for training in corporate sectors, they ask me, ma'am, can you complain for me? Can you make a complaint on my behalf? We all know that this person is harassing all the women employees. But if we go and complain, then we will lose our job. Or if we go and complain and the matter is known outside the company, then my mother-in-law or my husband will not allow me to continue to work and my career will suffer. So can you make a complaint? Unfortunately, no. As far as the law is concerned, the complainant herself must go and make the complaint. It is possible for her to take a friend or a lawyer or a senior member of the organization or even her husband or her sister or brother to make the complaint, but she must be there in person unless she has suffered some such grievous injury that she's under physical or mental agony or trauma to such an extent that she's not even able to come and make the complaint. Or if because of that, she has gone into severe depression and she has now become mentally incompetent or mentally or emotionally unable to come and make the complaint, only in that case can someone else make the complaint on her behalf along with an affidavit to her condition, saying that she is not able to come and make the complaint. Therefore, the relative, friend or guardian or mentor or someone else or lawyer can make a complaint on her behalf. Even in that case, it has to be somebody who knows what exactly happened. So it cannot be a family member who presumes, I think this happened. No, it has to be a person who actually knows what is supposed to have happened. So a complaint is based on facts, and that person who is making the complaint should be able to provide all the relevant facts that are required for the committee to take the complaint on. What is the time period for making a complaint? Ideally, immediately or within 3 months. So the maximum time limit is 3 months. So I'll explain this in a bit. One of the queries when we were working with the Me Too campaign that came up was, what do you do if a woman complains after 20 years, 22 years? And can you take that complaint as a serious complaint? And if it is a serious complaint, then why has she waited for 20 years before she came out with it? So all these issues are real factual issues. And they're not only issues of women, they are also issues that men face. I remember 1.5 years ago, I was providing training to boys, higher secondary school boys in one of the city schools. And a lawyer from my office, our partner office, had come. The lawyer will be about 32 years of age now, a man who is 32 years of age. So after the discussion with the young boys, when certain other things were happening during the workshop, this lawyer and I were talking, and then the lawyer comes up to me and says, do you know that when I was 15 years old, I was on a bus and I was sexually harassed and touched in an unwelcome way by a woman. And I was so terrified that I jumped out of the running bus and I fell and I tore my pants. And then since I didn't have money to buy a ticket, another ticket to go by another bus, I walked home and I reached home late. And because I was in such a dirty condition, my clothes were torn, my hair was messy, I was full of mud. And because I was late, my parents presumed that I had got into a fight. And my mother actually scolded me. And they kind of threatened to come to the school and see whether I was getting into fights. But I was not able to tell them that I had gone through sexual harassment on the bus. And he asked me, ma'am, how is it that I was not able to tell my mother? Why is it? And then he tells me, this is the first time I'm talking about it. 17 years after it has happened, this is the first time I'm talking about it. And you are the first person who knows, apart from the abuser and himself, that this has happened. He asked me, why is it so? Why have I not been able to talk about it? My answer is, I don't know. I don't know. Our brains work in very, very different ways. We are not able to say things that are very important, even to the people who are closest to us. And we cannot blame the victim for holding it back. There is no way that we can hold the victim responsible. It is very difficult that he says to me, ma'am, I could have called the conductor. I could have shouted, help, help. And the conductor could have come and I could have told him that this lady is doing this to me. But I was not able to do it. Why was I not able to do it? I have no answer. I don't know. Psychologists have been trying to answer this. Why is it that our brain goes into a kind of passive closure? We don't know what is happening. And for many years later, we are still in shock whenever we think about it. So the Act does not consider this. The Act says you must complain immediately. Failing that, it has to be within 3 months of the incident having occurred. Now, what happens if the incident is happening every day? First incident happened yesterday. Next incident happens 2 days later. The incident after that happens 2 days later. Suppose it is a serial offense. Then when is the 3 months? Is it from the first incident of sexual harassment or the last incident of sexual harassment? Answer is the last incident of a continuing offense. From that point, 3 months is the latest period by which a complaint can be taken up. So one of the very important activities that a complaint committee and the institution should do is to empower women to talk about their experiences so that these complaints will come out quickly. Otherwise, these complaints will get buried and maybe come out after 20 years or 25 years or never at all. What happens once the inquiry is received or complaint is received? The inquiry will be conducted within 7 days of the receipt of that complaint. The first step in that is that the respondent will be informed that a complaint has been given by this person. It depends on the committee whether they want to share the complaint itself or whether they just want to tell them that a complaint has come from this person. And an opportunity is given to the respondent to respond within 10 days. So within 10 days, the respondent has to come out and say whatever their defense is to that particular incident. If the respondent, if the company or the company or government body has an inquiry procedure, then it will proceed as per the inquiry procedure or disciplinary inquiry procedure. If there is no such procedure, then the internal complaints committee has to take that inquiry forward to whatever extent. And the rule is that in 3 months, any inquiry must be completed. So here is a very simple stage-wise diagram, receipt of the complaint. There has to be a planning meeting by the committee members where they sit and decide how shall we address this inquiry. And then investigation. So when Madam Revati asked me to give this session, she said, what is the evidence that the complaints committee has to look into? One very important aspect is that many of the incidents of sexual harassment will not happen in the public. Of course, it happens. It happens in, say, marriage functions, or it happens in temple yatras and functions. So it does. A lot of sexual harassment, of course, happens in the public. But in a workplace, It is very likely to happen inside the cabin of the superior officer, inside a toilet, or after hours, after everybody has left, on a silent corridor where nobody goes, or in a particular room or storeroom where nobody else is there. So collecting evidence is a difficult task and is also a complicated task. So how do you look at it? The first is you get the evidence from the complainant. You ask her, who witnessed it? Who was there with you? Who saw you? Whom did you tell? Say you faced some harassment in the cabin. You came running out. Whom did you first tell? So that person can give evidence. Other than that, the others may say, oh, she came running. She was crying. Her hair was in a mess. Her clothes were torn. So these people are witnesses. Apart from that, there can also be footage from video cameras. Nowadays, the rule is there that all public spaces should be covered with video cameras, CCTV cameras. So CCTV camera footage is useful. Logs, the log book. So when I was discussing with my husband, he said, if the respondent says that he was on leave that day, he didn't come to work at all, then the attendance register, the log book of the that is kept by the watchman or the person who is signing when you enter into a building. So those books, the registers that are maintained, those are important investigation tools. Apart from that, some institutions like the railways, they have special investigative bodies like the Railway Police Force. Maybe a school will have or college may have some kind of security system. So the people who are working in that security system, watchman, head of security, etc., they can help in investigation. One very important aspect of investigation is if there is a particular law that says or particular policy that women will not go into the storeroom after 6 o'clock. And if she was in the storeroom at 6 o'clock, or if someone invited her to the storeroom at 6 o'clock, then that by itself is a violation of the policy. It may not be a criminal offense, but a violation of the policy. Let me give you an example. If you go to a hospital as a woman alone, and you're going to be examined by a male doctor, then the law says, and also hospital committee rules and policies will say, that there has to be a woman attendant. So either the woman should be attended her relative or someone whom she brings along with her, or there should be a female nurse or medical personnel who is in the room while the woman is being examined. Now, this protects the doctor, the hospital, as well as the woman. So if there are particular policies that have been violated and this comes out during the investigation, it may point the internal complaints committee towards wrongdoing. From this investigation, there is a process of reasoning, and then there is a finding and recommendation, and then finally there is a report. So these are the steps. What does the complaints committee do when the complaint is received? The first is they have to receive the complaint in writing. It is very important that the complaint should be received in writing. If the person making the complaint is unable to write, maybe her hand is twisted, maybe she's illiterate, or maybe her hand is shivering or shaking because of shock, or maybe she's just not able to write, then it is necessary that the person receiving the complaint, who should be a member of the internal complaints committee, should take it down in writing then and there. As she's listening to it, she takes down the complaint in writing, and then she must read it out to the complainant and get it approved by the complainant, and then it becomes a complaint. They must, when the report or when the complaint is given to the respondent, it should also be in writing. It cannot be an oral query. It has to be a written order saying that this complaint has been made. Please come and respond. There is a process of conciliation which is provided for in the sexual harassment law. Conciliation is when the two parties who are disputing, who are fighting with each other, come together to have an amicable understanding about the situation. Can we talk about it? Can we settle it? Now, there are some activists and some lawyers who feel that this should not be there in the law. They feel that if you make the respondent and the aggrieved person sit together and say, you know, did this happen? Did this happen? Will it happen again? Will it happen again? Or did you feel bad? So when you put a woman like this in along with her attacker or or the respondent, then she's likely to feel threatened. And if she's feeling threatened, then she will not tell the truth. Or there may be a subtle pressure that is put on her, both by the committee as well as the person saying, okay, this time it's okay, next time it will not happen. So some people feel that conciliation is not a good thing. If you ask me, I feel that there are many types of sexual harassment which cannot be prosecuted in law. For instance, if there is harassment and I have to take that person to court, or if I want that person to be arrested, then I have to make out an offense under IPC or under any other law that is there, the Nirbhaya Act or whatever act. I have to say this offense happened and this offense or this offense can be brought under Section 376 of IPC or brought under any particular law of IPC or any other law related, or maybe he hit me, then I have to show that this comes under grievous injury in IPC. There are many other types of harassment for which probably there is no remedy in the penal code or in any other penal law. In that case, how do you deal with it? Definitely, you can wait for the ICC to come out with their report. But in the meantime, it is possible that in such cases, you just tell the person, I'm completely uncomfortable with that set of behavior or that kind of behavior. And therefore, a conciliation might actually work. An example is that many men sit in a way that they spread their legs. It is called man spreading. In the vast majority of the educated and progressive Western world, it is considered to be a form of subtle sexual dominance. So if there are 10 men and there is a single secretary working in that office at a lower or subordinate level, and all of the men have a certain way of sitting and it makes her feel afraid or threatened, then such a thing cannot be brought before the IPC, brought under the IPC or before the court. In such cases, it is a good idea to have a conciliation meeting where the woman is able to say what exactly is offending or troubling her. And it is possible that the other side might also understand and alter their behavior. So it depends. So my understanding would be that conciliation would depend, or the value of conciliation would depend on the complaint that is made. If there is very serious complaint like rape or assault or attempt to rape, then I would not say conciliation is a good thing. But if it is more about gender harassment, this kind of unconscious male behavior, then conciliation might actually work better and might help the company or institution to grow. If the conciliation is there and if the woman consents to the conciliation and both parties agree that they will not proceed with the inquiry, then there is a recording of the settlement by the Internal Complaints Committee, which is forwarded to the employer, and thereafter, no further inquiry is held. It's very important to plan the inquiry. Any legal inquiry is very difficult to carry out without a proper planning or proper strategy. So it's very important that the Internal Complaints Committee should be trained in how to conduct an inquiry. In India, we have this theory that 10 people can sit together and sort out any issue. So as lawyers, in particular my husband's firm, there is one, Ms. Kavita, who generally comes with me for sexual harassment training. So she tells, when we talk about it, she says, whenever there is a matrimonial issue between a husband and a wife, the family members of the husband and the wife sit together and they decide what the outcome will be. So in India, we have this kind of a social understanding that an inquiry can be carried out by completely random people who are untrained in the process of inquiry or untrained in the process of making decision making. But an internal complaints committee cannot work like that. Even if at the constitution of the committee, these people don't know how to make the law or how to read the law or how to interpret the law, over a period, they have to be trained on how the committee should work, how the inquiry should be conducted. During the period of inquiry, it is possible that the woman does not want to continue to work in that office. Maybe she feels threatened or embarrassed to come to work. Maybe there is gossip. Maybe other members of the company are asking her too many questions. Or maybe the person who is the respondent continues to work within in that work unit and she feels uncomfortable. Then it is possible to transfer either the complainant or the respondent, depending on the request of the complainant, to another unit, if there is another unit. And if there is no other unit, then to give them leave. So in organizations like the railways or the army or the police force, the complainant can be transferred to another unit. But if it's a college or a hospital with no branches, then by necessity, that woman may have to be given leave, paid leave. I think this is too going too deeply into inquiry. If you have questions, we can look at that. Rights of the respondent. So often when we talk about sexual harassment in any context, one of the questions that comes up is that women tell lies. That quite often the sexual harassment complainant has made a false complaint. Statistically, it has been proven that 94% of the time, the complaint is true. So only 6% of time, the complaint is false or has not been proved. So it is possible that the complaint itself is false, or it is possible that there is not sufficient evidence to convict the respondent. But 94% of the time, a person who has been victimized is telling the truth. So that leaves the other percentage. Does that mean that the respondent doesn't have rights? Yes, the respondent has rights. First, the respondent has the right to read the complaint and to answer it completely. The respondent cannot bring a lawyer to the internal complaints committee, but he has the right to take the advice of a lawyer. So he can take the complaint to a lawyer, sit with the lawyer and respond to it. And then, but when he submits the response has to be submitted by him. The respondent must be given both a hearing, so they should be able to speak, as well as a written response. And they should be listened to without judgment, without making a decision about them. And during this period, the internal complaints committee should ask the head of the unit or the management to issue a company-wide order or circular that certain things should not be discussed. There should be no gossip. There is no reason for people to be discussing these things, and people should pay attention to their work. Does it work, or is it going to convince everybody? No. But at least there will be a commitment from the side of the management that they are trying to reduce the discussion which may harm the respondent later. Even if the respondent is proved to be innocent, it may harm the respondent. So one of the ways is to keep the gossip to a lower level. The copy of the inquiry report should be given to the respondent. So whatever report, investigation materials, whatever they have identified, whatever the witnesses have said, all these statements also should be given to the respondent. And the respondent should be given an opportunity to reply to the report. If the internal complaints committee does not carry out its duties properly, then the respondent may require or may make a complaint to the management that the internal complaints committee is not doing its work properly. It is possible that the management may have to change the committee or change one or two of the members of the committee. Other relevant provisions that protect the respondent are punishment for false and malicious complaint, false evidence in accordance with whatever rules are there in civil law or criminal law, or in accordance with service rules if it is a government complaint, if it is a government institution. So in law, if a person tells lies and to convict a person, say the victim tell or the woman has told a lie, because of which the man, the respondent, could be punished for 4 years, then the same punishment will be given to her for making false and malicious complaint. In addition, she can also be asked to pay a compensation, a large amount of money, for having damaged the reputation or made it or spoiled the career of the respondent. Prohibition of publication or making known the contents of complaint or inquiry under RTI Act. So by law, the victim's name cannot be made public. And even in an inquiry proceeding, the inquiry proceedings cannot be released even under the RTI Act. So they have to be kept confidential. Only the report may come out, whether the respondent is guilty or not, victim's grievance has been redressed. The final inquiry report or final recommendations may be made public, but not the proceedings of the inquiry. And this is to protect the victim. And there is a penalty for publication. So there is a penalty for leaking this information to the public or to the press. Why? At the same time, the name of the victim must be kept confidential, but the name of the respondent need not be kept confidential, particularly after it is proved. So in our work, we have often found that it is not so much in work, but when we read newspapers about incidents of rape and so on, we know that they change the names of the victim, they change the names of the person who has suffered the assault, but not the names of the accused. This is the reason is that the accused must be made public so that no other person also suffers the same damage. Let us say that a person quits from this company because of allegations of sexual abuse or sexual harassment and goes and joins another company. If we keep their name confidential, then there may be some other victims in the other company. Making their names public is a good idea. Now, before I open the question, can we have some interaction here, or is it all me talking?
Yes, ma'am, you can have.
Yeah?
Yes, ma'am.
Any questions right now?
Dear professors, if you have any queries, you can clarify with her.
Right. What I'll do is, I'll open out a presentation that talks about preponderance of probability. And maybe you can share your views on this. Can you see my screen?
Yes,
ma'am. Are you able? Yeah, yes, yeah, yes. Good. Okay. So this is a presentation that we use in training internal complaints committee members. So it may be a little complicated, but it's very interesting, and I'm sure that you will all be feeling, will have something to participate, right? Now, quite often, one small issue that comes up is, how do you demonstrate genuine romantic interest in a person if the other person is going to treat it as sexual harassment? Okay, so when we work with people, we have this problem. Movies in India, in particular Tamil movies, but I'm sure Hindi movies and any other movie also, if a man wants to show romantic interest in a woman, the way he does it is by stalking her, by following her, by standing on roadsides and leering at her in a sexually transparent way, giving her gifts, which she refuses at the first level, singing songs, yes. So maybe forcing himself on her. But it is assumed that if a man is interested in a woman, then persistence will change her mind. And this behavior has been so deeply ingrained or embedded in our understanding of romantic or sexual relations that we often don't realize that there is criminality in that behavior. I'll give you an example. I teach ethics and sexual harassment to young boys. So last around February or March, I was at this government school, government boys school, ninth standard boys. And we were discussing how to demonstrate responsible behavior towards women. And one question I asked them was, if there was a girl student who was to come in to your class, to a class of ninth standard boys, if a girl from ninth standard was to walk in, then what are the 5 rules that you will follow? So they very quickly said, oh, we'll ensure that Padgapa Vichapon, we will be friendly with her, we will protect her privacy, we will, two, three other things. So polite, we will be polite to her, etc. So then I said, okay, very nice. Now you tell me, how will you demonstrate all these? These are good words, good values. How are you going to demonstrate these things? They didn't understand. So I said, okay, for instance, safety. How will you ensure her safety? So they said, ma'am, we will follow her back to her house to see that she is safe. And when she comes to school, we will follow her. We will come with her. So I said, if she says, don't come with me, I don't want you to come with me, I'm quite safe, don't worry, I will come by myself, then what will you do? Then we will hide and follow her. We will not let her know that we are following her. Why are you following her? We are following her to see that she is safe. Now, this is the understanding of people in India or in Tamil Nadu or in Chennai about how to keep a person safe. Now, I asked them, where do you learn this from? So most of the values for men in India and in Tamil Nadu in particular come from 2 places, from their mother and from movies. It is difficult to deny. The mother has a great influence on how the men and boys are brought up and equally on how the women and girls are brought up. But movies are the second most influential areas from which young boys and girls get their education. Where is the father? In many families in the lower income group, the father is not a great role model. In most families, they are not a regular feature of family life. Even in families that are urban, upper class, educated, reasonably well settled economically, these families, the father is hardly there at home. The father might leave to go to work at 8 o'clock in the morning and come back at 8 o'clock or 9 o'clock. Their interaction with their boy children is very minimal. So we have to understand that men don't get their cues from role models who are men. They get their cues from movies and their cues from other peer group interaction. So it's very interesting and important to understand these things as we look at the interaction. Look at this next part of my presentation. Okay, now I don't know how are we going to interact. Can you all unmute yourselves and answer? Whenever you want to answer, can you just unmute yourself and answer? That way we can get an answer. Now, a man giving a book of love poetry to a woman, is it sexual harassment?
May not be.
Why not?
Probably he thought the poetries are very good for a read. He may not have this underlying intent of approaching her in that way, in a romantic way. Probably okay. So we are saying
he enjoys the poetry and he may not have a sexual interest in the woman. So, but he's giving the, Male employee giving a book of love poetry to a female employee. Is this sexual harassment?
Maybe they are friends beyond being just employees.
Okay. So if you are the internal complaints committee.
I would give a fair hearing to both.
Very good. Senior male employee giving a book of love poetry to a junior female employee.
Maybe the intentions are not all that good.
Senior male employee who is the supervisor of the female junior employee to whom he is giving a book of love poetry.
High degree of doubt.
High degree of doubt. And the female supervisee employee is not able to say no, then is it sexual harassment?
Definitely.
It becomes sexual harassment. Definitely. And so, as an internal complaints committee member, yes, you have received a complaint saying that my senior is giving me a book of love poetry. And when I'm saying no, no, he's just putting the book. Oh, no, 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 keep the book, keep the book, keep the book. Will you have an understanding that it is sexual harassment or not?
My first understanding would be it's a sexual harassment. But still, I think he also deserves a hearing.
No doubt, no doubt. Okay, one more example. A man writing a poem about a woman?
Need not necessarily be sexual harassment. Depends on the content of the poem.
Poem, exactly. About the physical, attractive physical attributes or clothes of a woman.
Again, depends on the relationship they share with each other. The comfort level, as you mentioned in your talk.
Yes. Suppose it is a senior male supervising employee writing a poem about the attractive physical attributes of a junior supervisee female employee.
That's again a high degree of doubt.
High degree of doubt. So very, very interesting to understand how the situation keeps changing from moment to moment. So the first point is that there is nothing wrong about writing a poem about a woman. You might write a poem about Saraswati or Mother India. There's nothing wrong about that. But as soon as the question of physical attributes come, then the question becomes, is it sexually oriented or not? Now, when I remember one particular case that Kavita and I did, where a woman employee complained that every morning when she came to office, there was a rose on her table, a single rose on her table. And she was not able to know who is putting that rose on her table. So the first 5-6 days, there was a big laugh. People would laugh about it, joke about it, secret admirer, this, that. But after a month, she became very jittery. She dreaded to come to work. So in the morning, she would rush early. She said, okay, let me go before the rose is there on the table. Let me go at 7:30 and see who is putting the rose at the table. That was one aspect. The second aspect is she was suspicious of nearly every male employee in the office, looking, you know, is it this guy? Is it this guy? That guy is looking at me like this. This person spoke to me today. Why is he avoiding me? Is he the person who is putting the rose on my table? Now, it may happen that the male employee thinks it's a very romantic gesture. You know, maybe the male employee's frame of mind is, I am making a romantic overture to a female employee, assuming that it's a proper relationship, whatever it is, okay? That's an appropriate relationship, not a senior-junior relationship. But what is it doing to the female? So in sexual harassment law, and in nearly every other harassment law, for instance, POCSO, Prevention of Child Sexual Abuse Offences, in Offences Act, there too, it is not the intention or the frame of the mind of the offender that is taken into consideration. It is not my intention. I gave you a rose, I didn't intend it to be a sexual gesture. That is immaterial. But what happens to the person who is at the receiving end of the attention, receiving end of the gift, receiving end of the book or the poem, or receiving end of the sexual advance? That is what is taken into consideration. Why is that so? So when I teach also professional ethics in several institutions, and when I teach professional ethics to college students, one of the things they ask me is this: then in this society, a woman doesn't easily express her interest in men, a particular man or a particular boy. So it is up to the men to take the first step. It is up to the men to first express interest. And if they express interest and it is taken as sexual harassment, then how are we ever going to have a relationship with that person? The answer to that is that perhaps the first time it may not be considered as sexual harassment.
It has to be taken in the view that a person was making an innocent overture or an innocent advance. But once the girl or once the woman or the woman employee says, no, I'm not interested, any further pursuing of that person or any further gift giving to that person or any further interaction with that person should be considered to be sexual harassment. So it's a very, very nebulous line, gray line between what is harassment and what is not when there is a genuine interest on the part of the man. But this is how it is. So one of the very interesting videos that I generally show is, I don't know if I can share. Is it possible to share a video, sir, from YouTube, Mr. Nibin?
Nibin, sir?
Can I share a video?
It's possible.
How will the volume go, sir?
We'll be able to hear.
Okay. So with this video, I end my presentation. I invite you to watch this. Can you see it?
Yes.
Okay. No. Are you able to hear?
No, ma'am. No volume.
So how do I do that, sir? Mr. Nibin, can you help me? Or I can share the link to you. Can you play it from your end, sir? Because unlike Zoom, this is not showing me share.
Amrita, ma'am. Can you help her? Is it possible for you to
audio help? Part, I'm just thinking, because so far I only given voiceover for all the videos.
I see. So what I'll do is I will just share the link with you on chat and I invite you to watch it. It's a very, very well put video and it has something that we can learn. So I'm putting it there. It's called Tea and Consent. It's made by BBC. So I invite you to look at it. Yeah. So my presentation is done. I'm open to questions.
Speaking about social media,
yes.
I have a huge complaint about these movies which are being made maybe today more. The hero stalking the heroine and finally the heroine falls in love with him out of compulsion. So how does it go? Just a minute, it started playing. So is there any option to have a case against such people? That gives wrong ideas to the boys, I think.
Totally, totally, ma'am. I mean, I cannot understand. But I think it's a very old traditional practice, I think, in our society. So therefore, it's very difficult to wipe that out. So the censorship, the office that takes care of these things. I don't know, ma'am. I don't know the answer to this. So there are laws that are against stalking and assault, but they are not applied to movies. So there are activists who are talking about it, saying that we should go to the Film Producers Council or the board for censorship and then ask them to remove these scenes or not allow these scenes to be played, or if these scenes are there, then the movie should be classified as A. If that is done, then to some extent we protect young children from these attitudes. But as of now, no step like that is being taken. In fact, it's horrendous. It's not just social media and movies. It is also there nowadays on these TV serials. So which is there in our house being played continuously throughout the day. In fact, one of the areas of interest that we have when we talk about protection of children is serials like Big Boss, which are not specified as a reality television like Big Boss, which are not specified as adult content. So the rules should be more strict about what young children are watching. And this includes not just social media access, but also movies and TV. I hope somebody takes it up, but yes, I don't have an answer to that.
Thank you. Just one more question finally
yes.
from me.
Sure.
The instances which you showed. So the yes. boy may be totally innocent. It may be that the girl has designs on that boy, and if she fabricates a complaint, what are the chances for the boy? Because it's suppose there are no proofs. It's her word against his. So how does it go?
It is really so. It does happen. It does happen, and it does happen because of jealousy. It happens. So the cases that we have dealt with, it has happened because of jealousy. It has also happened because of a prior relationship that has broken up, and happens because of also professional jealousy that somebody is doing better than them. In that case, I think that is one way, one reason why we should have a proper framework. If the person is not able to prove his innocence, at least they can show that they have followed all the policies, they have not taken any shortcuts or in the carrying out of their duties. That's about all that they can do. Most of the time, the evidence will be murky. They may not be able to find all the evidence that is required to either exonerate them or convict them.
Thank you.
Sorry, yeah. I'm not able to provide X.
Yes,
you know,
yes,
I'm,
yes. I got it.
It doesn't exist. Yeah. Yes, ma'am.
Ma'am, the video is ready. Yes. Mr. Nabin said he can play it for
us. Why don't we play that? And then we will talk maybe another 5.
Yes, sir.
If you're still struggling with consent, just imagine instead of initiating sex, you're making them a cup of tea. You say, hey, would you like a cup of tea? And they go, oh my God, I would love a cup of tea. Thank you. Then you know they want a cup of tea. If you say, hey, would you like a cup of tea? And they're like, you know, I'm not really sure. Then you can make them a cup of tea or not, but be aware that they might not drink it. And if they don't drink it, then, and this is the important bit, don't make them drink it. Just because you made it doesn't mean you're entitled to watch them drink it. And if they say, no, thank you, then don't make them tea at all. Just don't make them tea. Don't make them drink tea. Don't get annoyed at them for not wanting tea. They just don't want tea, okay? They might say, yes, please, that's kind of you. And then when the tea arrives, they actually don't want the tea at all. Sure, that's kind of annoying as you've gone to all the effort of making the tea, but they remain under no obligation to drink the tea. They did want tea, now they don't. Some people change their mind in the time it takes to boil the kettle, brew the tea, and add the milk. And it's okay for people to change their mind, and you are still not entitled to watch them drink it. And if they're unconscious, don't make them tea. Unconscious people don't want tea, and they can't answer the question, do you want tea? Because they're unconscious. Okay, maybe they were conscious when you asked them if they wanted tea, and they said yes, but in the time it took you to boil the kettle or brew the tea and add the milk, they are now unconscious. You should just put the tea down, make sure the unconscious person is safe, and this is the important part again, don't make them drink the tea. They said yes then, sure, but unconscious people don't want tea. If someone said yes to tea, started drinking it, and then passed out before they'd finished it, don't keep on pouring it down their throat. Take the tea away. Make sure they are safe, because unconscious people don't want tea. Trust me on this. If someone said yes to tea around your house last Saturday, that doesn't mean they want you to make them tea all the time. They don't want you to come around to their place unexpectedly and make them tea and force them to drink it, going, but you wanted tea last week, or to wake up to find you pouring tea down their throat, going, but you wanted tea last night. If you can understand how completely ludicrous it is to force people to have tea when they don't want tea, and you are able to understand when people don't want tea, then how hard is it to understand when it comes to sex? Whether it's tea or sex, consent is everything. And on that note, I'm going to make myself a cup of tea.
Thank you so much, sir. So, yeah. It's time for my tea also.
Audience, any questions to ma'am? Yes. Yes, I think the silence says that no questions.
Either they have understood everything or they have understood nothing.
No, I think they have understood. Yeah. But you will get the questions, ma'am.
No problem, ma'am. Yeah. Revati ma'am has my details. Yeah. You can feel free to write me or send a message to my WhatsApp. I'd be happy to answer. And if you can collect all the questions and then share it in one email, then it'll be even easier to answer.
Sure.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. And I would like to thank you on behalf of our management, principal, staff and students for being here with us and creating an awareness on prevention of sexual harassment for our teachers and students. You have spoken about what is sexual harassment, whom to complain, how to complain, and when to complain, and the rights of the respondent. So I think the it is very clear to the audience, and how the ICC can take up the process. So it is all very clear for us. Definitely any doubts, we'll get back to you for any kind of help, ma'am. And you also talked about ICC. I just want to keep informing you that we have an ICC internal complaints committee here, and we have our Associate Dean Dr. Devasundari as the chairperson for the committee, and we have three internal members, Ms. Linu Sam, Ms. Dr. Kavita Malabankan, Kavita Balamurugan, and Ms. Revati as the internal member, and we have an external member, Ms. S. Divya. She's from an NGO called Bhoomi. So we have committee members also, and this has been passed on as an information to the staff also, that the community is there and it is functioning. And we are also looking into the whatever the complaints we get it now.